Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, but first, the daily contemplation. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddhist noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air. Number 44, recorded in November, 11th November, the year 2016 on planet Earth, on Sri Lanka, on Nagas Mountain, in a small place, new location, called the temple. As you can see here on this 360, it is a very nice place with rocks and gentle water sounds as background. And the backdrop of this stone wall goes directly up, and there's wild orchids falling down the stone wall, and fern trees, and palms, and various shrubs. And then it opens to the gate to heaven, which is why I call this place the temple. Small place, cool. Sometimes very noisy with roaring water, but today It's a gentle dripping, as I'm sure you can hear. There are four questions and one Kathina robe offering ceremony, because this is a Kathina month. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tasso Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. The Kathina robe offering comes right after the rains retreat, the vassa, which has just finished. It starts usually in the full moon of October or November. Then in the coming month, it's the only period where the lay people are allowed to offer robes to the monks. It can be either October or November, between these full moons. And the history of it goes like that, at the Buddhist time, usually the monks will come before the rains retreat, which lasts 3 months, where you're not allowed to travel around. You should stay the same place and do more intense meditation. Then they come to the Buddha. Then he looks into their mind, embrace their mind, evaluate their mind, and give them a particular meditation object, a kammatthana, which they then go out in the jungle and utilize by meditation, severe meditation, 8-10 hours a day or more, in order to gain enlightenment. Then after the rains retreat, they come back to the Buddha and report their results. And then some 30 monks, they were after the rains retreat coming back towards a monastery where the Buddha was staying. But then a very, very heavy rain started. So they had to stay where they were. They could not go because the roads were flooding and the bridges were flushed down, the rivers and so on. So there was they couldn't travel. So they stayed where they were until the floods receded. And then they went back to the Buddha. And then, meantime, some lay people have given him some cloth, some robe cloth. And then he commended the Bhikkhus, the monks, that they stayed the same place while waiting for the water to recede. And then he gave him this robe cloth that he have just received from the lay people. And from that they stitched up the robes in one day and night. And so goes the rule, you have to stitch up the robe in one day and night. And to that they used in the old days a framework, vertical frame, where they put out the cloth, and then there was two men sitting on each side of the frame. So one man, he put in the needle here, and another man took it out and put it in again, and then, so it was kind of like an old sewing machine, Kathina frame. So the Kathina, word Kathina actually means the frame that you are using to stitch the robe with. But today we don't use these frames anymore. We use manual sewing machines, and then put it out on the floor, as you see here in the pictures. In the Uposotha hall, in the observance day hall, and then stitch it up after certain rules. So this is a historical background for the Kathina ceremony, of which I've just been participating in two, after invitation to the local monasteries, where it is a local high time. You can say it's the second most holy month after Vesak, or third probably, something in that order. So it's celebrated all over the island here. And the report from these two visits, where you will see how traditional Buddhist, Orthodox Theravada Buddhists here in Sri Lanka, they donate their robe
will come right here. I just like to say that one observation I made, which it made me very happy, is that the two head monks at these both these local monasteries, they displayed a very nice feature of humility and humbleness. The Buddhist saying goes like this: you should be humble as a doormat. And they showed this, both of them, consistently by the fact that when the lay people have sat down, then they preach them to them, the Dhamma. So they get spiritual food to the lay people. And then they served, participated in the serving of the visiting monks, me among 20 other monks or so, in both places. And then when these two tasks has been fulfilled, that they serve spiritual food to the lay people in that supported their monastery and the local lay people around the monastery, and they have served and serviced the monks, the visiting monks, then after that they would get a plate of food and sit in the corner and eat a little bit until that next task of speech was coming up. And this made me very happy to see that. And also, every time I visit these local monasteries, the devotion and faith, satta, sa-un, da heart, something that comes from the heart, devotion, is very deep in the people here in Sri Lanka. And they listen really intently on the Dhamma, often with closed eyes, the closer eyes, as you will see, in the Kathina report, which comes right here.
Tatiyampi dhamman saranam gacchami. Tatiyampi sangham saranam gacchami. Sirvam nama kritiyo thunai ke. Eo paridi, eo unmahante. Eo bhimata varaya, nirakam nivadila, tamayi ke dhuri jivarte. Dine kartya maraya, sunam, vipu sangasade.
Tree leaves from the Bodhi tree, the enlightenment tree. Yes.
Very nice.
Yes. Next time I bring light.
Okay.
Did you light, huh? Otherwise, no see. Super. Hyundai. Okumari, huh?
Okumari.
It's a rope catched together, and this is a ball with upside down. Another rope, ball upside down. This is a set you typically give ball and rope.
Vidya Akartama Vidamtamna Varadvajanasama Ramaniyam Prasannamu Sammanusumana Andayaneva Mukas Bhikkhu Sanghas Tema To Nibbana Sampatti Minate Samindra Chanda Sekara Prajapatyadi Samasta Diviraja Samohya Vising Ping Pandru Vasing Anumodam Manula Vatva Yama Devi Angi
Thank you.
Polantende Sri Sudarshanaram Viharasthane Didastasi Kapita Mahapinkama
Sarnam Gacchami Dhammam Sarnam Gacchami Sangram Sarnam.
Ablakalo is Suri Pitipasada from Salem. Suri is right.
Kapati Chitam Patitam Tuyam Samijyatu Purem Tu Chitta Santappa Chando Vanna Raso Yata Mani Jyoti Raso Yata.
Malpochi.
Malpochi?
Pittala, pittala.
Pittala.
Malvas.
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 Quindi si doveva, i luoghi veri. Quindi si doveva, i luoghi veri, i duc veri, i vasevoli veri, suo pat veri, suo pat veri, suo pat veri. May you be happy, may you be free. Thank you. Kila sampada, a small drink. So it's because you have taken Panchasila, huh?
Yeah, Panchasila, yeah. This is really the spirit move.
Yes. So you remind him if he had taken Panchasila.
Panchasila, yeah.
So much for the Kathina Robe offering and the history behind it. I'd just like to finish also this. I've got a new robe. You don't need a new robe every year, but in the way, if you live in the forest, probably every third or second or fifth year, because you rip it while going in the jungle. And this year, a donor from Singapore have donated the funds for a robe to me, and it's being stitched up inside candy. And I will fetch it here next week. And I'd like to thank you, this donor, who has acquired a special merit on this account, of which we say that the future result is a physically beauty and good-lookingness, and also protection from disease, from cold, heat, sweat and dirt, just like a robe protects a monk. So thank you for that. Pin, and much merit be yours. Question 143 goes like this. As a Buddhist, how can we scientifically reconcile some of the facts about the previous Buddha, Kassapa, said that he had lived in, more than 500 million years ago, and given that Homo sapiens have been on Earth at most 200,000 years, and that his body was 20 cubits, one cubit is like this, so roughly 10 meters high, after I lived for 20,000 years. Yes, good question, thank you for that. And this, if you go into the Buddha Vamsa and read about all the former 10 former Buddhas there, then they have various heights, and many of them are much higher than we are today. And what's the explanation for that? They also have much longer lifetime. The next Buddha would be around 80 meters high and be in the live around 80,000 years. And there's two reasons for it. If we take the height first, the physical distance first, then distances are not the same. So because of space-time relativity, space and time are dilating and contracting. And because of a fact that has recently been proven scientifically, which is called gravitational waves that are coming through space. If a gravitational wave hits a meter stock, then the meter will become shorter and then longer, and then shorter and shorter, and then it will wave out again. Or it will stand oscillating. It's a very small amount, depending on the strength of the amplitude of the gravitational wave and its frequency. The gravitational wave that came was recently experimentally verified by an observatory called LIGO, a laser interferometer gravitational wave instrument in USA. There's two of them, one in Washington and one in Louisiana, which is two laser beams that goes around 2 miles back and forth. And then you can measure the distance they go back and forth very, 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 very accurately. Less than a thousandth of an electron a variation. And there you can see at this long length, approximately a mile, it becomes a little shorter and longer, because you can measure this with laser light very accurately. So gravitational waves have been was predicted by Albert Einstein with his special relativity in 1915, but has not been experimentally verified for these 100 years. The first time it's seen is this year, where it was found by two black holes rotating around each other and thereby colliding. And when they were rotating across each other, black holes, because of very, very forced gravitational forces which entrap lights, attract light, so light cannot come out of them, information cannot come out of them, except Hawking radiation. That's another issue. They are bending space-time very, very much. So they are bending space-time extremely. And this extreme bending of space-time that is passing in front of each other and shadowing each other, it produces waves, gravitational waves. So now we know that this is a fact, they exist. Basically, it will cause variation in length when they hit whatever object. And it will also cause variation in the speed of time. So this means that all these calculations of how long time Earth has existed, how long times carbon dating, for example, they are somewhat obsolete because they are not based on relativistic calculation. Relativity, space-time relativity, has not been taken into account making these calculations. And it means that space and time is not absolute. If a space-time wave is hitting you and you are holding a meter stock, then the meter stock will be longer and shorter and longer and shorter, but so will you. And so also will the Buddhas in the former times. What can be the frequency and wavelength of these space-time gravitational waves? We don't know. We don't know. This can cause huge variation in length and in the way space is dilating up. So space is also expanding because of the Big Bang, and this means that also you and I are expanding. And the next Buddha, he will also be expanding. And it's like everything is expanding, like the distance between raisins in a raisin bread become larger and larger as the dough of the raisin bread increases during fermentation. So everything becomes bigger, and during these gravitational waves, time can also go slower. So since there can be many other, this was just one event that was within a frequency range easily registered by these two instruments, where you could see the gravitational wave passing one instrument and then passing the other instrument somewhat later. And thereby it was proof of the pudding that this was a gravitational wave hitting Earth. How big these gravitational waves can be and what their frequencies can be is not known. But other cataclysmic events out in space, as supernovae colliding, big bangs in other universes, in the multiverse, can also cause these ripples in space-times and probably also shock waves in space-times that is hitting Earth. Their frequency can be from a few per second and maybe 100,000 per second. And it can maybe also be one per 100,000 years. So the frequency of the wave and thereby the wavelength can be from enormous to very, very small. So nobody knows what the frequency spectrum of these gravitational waves are. And thereby, you can say that nobody knows at present what is the variation in space and in time, the time dilation, and what the effect does it mean on our calculation of carbon dating, for example, which is based on that the radioactive decay of certain carbon isotopes, that is constant over time. That the half-life is constant over time. This should be implied that the speed of time goes with the same rate over all cosmic time. But that we know already, that's not the case. That's not the case. So all these calculations has to be corrected. And I think they will be corrected in the upward manner. So humans has been existing on Earth probably more than one time. There's probably, in between, the Buddha says, talk about almost close to extinction of the human species. And this means also, even if we have existed for 200,000 years, if there was another human civilization for 576 billion years ago, there would be no archaeological or fossil record left, because nothing is left after 500 million years. You cannot find fossil records. Even stones are evaporating at that rate. So much of our biological understanding, and also lots of our cosmic understanding, and thereby the understanding of ourselves and our place in the universe, it has to be corrected. And that's what science is all about. It's about correcting wrong views. So it's always work in progress. Science never comes to any absolute truth. Science itself has no epistemological or ontological privilege according to other areas of knowledge. Why not? Because science is basically a cultural achievement. It's a cultural phenomenon. There's fashions within sciences. I've been a scientist myself, so I know the fashions, they are shifting. Then this is in that subject and in where that is out. And then you can get money for this, but not that, and so on. It has nothing to do with objectivity. It has something to do with culture. It's a cultural phenomenon. So, and secondly, if you look at science today, it's a very mixed, not entirely clean business, because there's a lot of scientists, hundreds or thousands of them. They are their salaries come from governments and other funding agencies, and they have to publish to get this funding. If you don't publish, you don't get any funding. So you have to publish. So people publish whatever. Even what do you do if you make an experiment, you don't find anything? There's nothing to publish. Then the pressure to publish anyway, to publish something that you didn't find, that is basically scientific fraud, is very large. And if you ask scientists of today, whether medical scientists or biological scientists or geologists or physicists or chemists or whatever, then they will say, 50% of them will say that there is a reproducibility crisis in science today. 50% of them will say that. Because they have all experienced that they get a scientific paper with some findings. There's a method. Then they follow the method. And then they should reproduce the findings in this scientific paper. But they cannot reproduce the findings. They cannot reproduce the findings. So what? Then they write a letter or email to the scientist. No answer. What's that about? Then they write to the funding agency, and so on. So there's a lot of clutter of that. So science is not scientists, even though they have a white lab coat. It doesn't make them priests in any kind of religion that is more holy than anybody else. And it cannot produce absolute knowledge. It's not an asymptotic kind like approach to an absolute knowledge. Because sometimes there's very large fractures, for example, relativity, that space and time is not two things that are the same, as a constant block of space and a time that is proceeding inside the space with constant rate, that they can contract and dilate, and they do it when these gravitational waves are hitting us. This was a scientific revolution. So there, suddenly knowledge is completely broken up, and the world and physics and carbon dating and archaeology and so on, they are still reeling from the shock of relativity. that is now is from 1915. It is now more than 100 years ago. So it says something that we have difficulties with understanding things when we have been clinging to a view of constant space and absolute space, constant time, absolute time. And they are two different things, not one thing. This we have differences with releasing that view, because that is how we experience it. Let's say, for example, a gravitational wave hits you, and you become you become 100 meters high for 1 minute, and then you shrink again back. Then you hold a meter stock in front of you. It's 1 meter. Here it's 1 feet, 1 feet paper. But the paper also becomes larger and smaller. It's become 30 meters high, and then it shrinks down to 1 feet after 1 minute. Then it starts slowly oscillating down. So you have no access to information about this dilation of space, nor have you any access to the dilation of time in that particular event of a gravitational wave passing. So it fools perception. Because all the references we make to distances and enduring of time, these instruments are also affected by these gravitational waves, and also by time expansion after the Big Bang, which is accelerating, and so forth. So I think these numbers are very much wrong, actually. And even if we say they are right, then Earth has existed for 5 billion years. So four Buddhas have passed. This should then, if there's one human civilization for each Buddha, then this should take only 2 billion years. And the Earth has existed for 5 billion years. The universe has existed for 14 billion years. But these numbers may be underestimated by a factor of 1,000, or more than that, 100,000, because of non-relativistic calculation. So much for the length. Then what about the life length? The life length of a Galapagos turtle is 500 years. There's nobody who knows why this creature can live 500 years. And we can only live 100 years. So the life length, the biological life length, what determines that, nobody knows. If you take a cell line out and then they let it divide, then after 20 divisions, the cell starts to die off. Because the end of the chromosomes become longer and longer, the so-called telomeres, they become longer and longer, and if they're not chopped off, then the cell line will die out. This is within these event, biomolecular events, are within the size realm of quantum mechanics, where probability affects the phenomena. Hereby also karma. And that's the way, if the karma of the animal for the Galapagos means very long life length, it's a strictly vegetarian, and have been so for so long back, then it will affect his life length. He doesn't kill anybody. And same also with humans. We are not strictly vegetarians. We kill other beings. And so our life length will shrink by probabilistic laws. And this means the maximum is said to be in the text 100,000 years. And the minimum is around 8 years. No, 10 years, sorry, 10 years. And so, no, 8 years, 8 years, yeah. 8 years, 8 years, the girls get pregnant at the bottom of when the human population has degraded maximally. Incest is going on both between mother and daughter and father and son in almost all families. Then the daughters, they become pregnant at the year at the earth at the age of 4, so they can give birth at the age of 4. So there, the whole human life has been compressed into 8 years. So they reach maturity after 4 years. Now it's around 16 years, huh? 14 years, 15 years, like that, menstruation, and thereby fertility starts for the female. So there also you see the other scientific revolution of this century, or the former century, sorry, from the 1927 and forward, quantum mechanics, affects on the biological level, the life length of biological beings, because it determines mutation rates, cancer rates, resistance to ultraviolet radiation, telomere length, and all these events, they are within the quantum mechanical realm of efficacy, and thereby they are determined by probability, and thereby they are determined by karma. So the Buddha Kassapa, he had karma to live for 20,000 years. Buddha Maitreya, he has karma to live for 80,000 years. And so will the humans around him also at that time. They will have very, very good karmic accumulation. Very, very good karmic accumulation. Can only go up to 100,000 years. So they are in the top 80%. This shows that I'm not saying that the rational analysis of science should be ditched. I'm just saying that it's not the only tool in the toolbox to get absolute knowledge. This tradition, Theravada tradition, is called Vibhajyavada, and it's called the analytical approach. So rational analysis is very much part of Vibhajyavada school of Buddhism, early Buddhism, Theravada Buddhism. But it's not the only tool. There's also another thing called synthesis. So there's analysis, you take the thing apart, and there's synthesis, you put things together. And this Western science has difficulties with putting all the parts together and giving one coherent view of how reality actually works. Psychologically, biologically, mentally, chemically, physically, cosmologically. It's a little bit science here, a little bit there, a little bit here, a little bit there. But if you try to put the pieces together, they don't fit. And there in the synthetical department, which is a cross scientific talk, there has to be consistency. This is one message of philosophical method of Vibhajyavada. There's analysis and synthesis. Two. First you take it apart, then you reach nothingness, then you put the parts together again, then you reach allness. When you've done both ways around, you know the object. Then you sit down and do what? Meditation. So this is the contemplative method. This is the third tool in the toolbox. There one have another kind of information about the object. It's not an observer grasping the object and either cutting it up in pieces or putting the pieces together, as if from outside. It's the observer identifying with the object and thereby, in some sense, becoming the object, being absorbed into the object, and thereby getting direct knowledge about how this object is on the absolute scale. So this means that analysis is not enough. As the Buddha, pointed out, sound reasoning and rational analysis cannot hammer out absolute truth, anya. One has to have the contemplative method also. One has to reflect upon it systematically, during concentration, ideally during absorption, ideally during first jhana. Then suddenly it appears to one how it is, how it really is. The scientists, they will call it intuition. And it's sometimes they will have that on the toilet or in the bus or at very strange places where they're not thinking about science. They will tell about it like that. That's very and very unsystematic. It's kind of like a happy chance that the intuition comes into the mind and sees some distorted, thinly veiled aspects of absolute reality suddenly and in short, very short time. But then they pollute this intuition by alcohol, dining and wining on scientific conferences, also this fraud with the scientific papers and not entirely truth by when seeking funds and so on, competition with colleagues and all kinds of other stuff. So thereby this intuition, the accuracy of this intuition and the frequency of it coming, it goes down. And this dilute their ability as a scientist. So science is okay. It can take you up to a certain level. But above that level, one has to do contemplation, systematic contemplation. Science is forever a relative knowledge field. It's always work in progress. It never reached the absolute level where you cannot come higher, where you cannot come to know more. So much for question 143. 35 minutes in. And the short answer is relativity. And for the biological life length, there is variation in it, and it's karmically related. Question 144. Should we stop using I, me, mine in our daily speech and thought? Please explain no self, the anatta characteristic in Buddhism. Yes, yes and no. Of course, you. This is I, me, you, is an our name A, B, or whatever. Albert Einstein. When we use a name like that, then it refers to a special individuality that we thereby can locate and reference to. So on the conventional level, samuchisatya, it's very practical. So for pragmatic reasons, we have to use these designations. Because in a social group, you should point out one person up, please you and you go over and take this and that and bring it here and give it to this and that person. So there you have to use these pointers, these references and reference in a social group. So it's impossible not to use them. But one should not use them just knowing that they are just conventional truth. They're not absolute truth. Paramatta satya. They're only conventions, social conventions. Somebody have said that language is a virus from outer space. And there's some truth to it, because it imposes or kind like introduces concepts as entities and as egos and selves that are the same from one time point to another, both in here and out there. That is actually not true. But if you should rename this individuality, then you should call me Bande 1, Bande 2, Bande 3, Bande 4. And actually, you should do this a billion times per second. It's not practical. And same thing with you and any other individual. So renaming is not the way out of this conundrum between the conventional linguistic use of the term I, me, and the absolute sense. What one can do to see how much one understands of this no self and how much egoism still is embedded in one's mind is to notice it, both in especially easily in print and in writing emails. So you write, let's say, 10 lines of emails, then you count how many times you say I, me, mine. If there's 10 I, me, mines for 10 lines of text, then then there's significant egoism in this mind that is writing this email. And this entails that this person has probably not yet fully understood this no-self principle. I took this thing that was mine and brought it to them. This can also be formulated in passive form. This phenomenon was brought to these individualities. So there's no persons there, no I, me, mine, egos there. They're just some state, some phenomena that undergoes some process, some activity. But there's no actors. There's no one who acts, who brings, and then there's no one who receives. Please explain the no-self and other characteristic. Yes, it is notoriously difficult to understand, but I think I thought about it, explaining it like this. There's nobody home. Remember that. Nobody home. Most views about ego is that there is a self inside this body, living inside this body as a person living inside a house. But where is it? If you cut up the body, where's the self? Can you show it to me? It's in the heart, in the brain. Where is it? It's not to be found. So there's nobody home. There's no self in the body. The same thing if you say, the self is my feeling, my emotions, my emotional attitudes towards others or other things or phenomena. And then also there, these emotions, they're changing all the time. This change from pleasant feeling to painful feeling to neutral feeling, this happens 10 times per second or a billion times per second. So how can there be any self embedded in this fluctuating and passing states of different feelings? So also in the house, in the emotional house, there's nobody home there. Nobody home. You knock the door, doesn't open. You open the door, looks in, there's nobody there. Nada. It's empty of self. It's empty of sameness. Same also with the perception, visual perception, auditory perception, olfactory perception, gustatory perception, tactile perception, and mental perception. These perceptions are also changing as you hear and try to understand this speech. Hear this river, this creek, changing all the time. How can there be any same self in there, in this house of perception, in this house of experience? If you open this house, which is like a box of films and audio recordings and recordings of all kinds of data, visual data, sound data, chemical data on the tongue and in the nose and so on, tactile data, physical data, then inside this big house of the library of past perception and present perception and dreams of future perception, there is no wish list of future perception. There's nothing same there. It's always changing. Always changing. Same thing about the mental construction, the thinking, and in particular consciousness. Consciousness is also changing. You're conscious about something different from one moment to the next moment. Whether I'm saying something, or you're hearing something, or you're seeing something, or noticing something, or in the surroundings, or the color of my robe, or the meaning of what I'm saying, is always the content of your consciousness, of which there is six, namely visual consciousness, consciousness of seeing something, auditory consciousness, being conscious about hearing something, gustatory consciousness, and olfactory consciousness, consciousness of taste and of smell, tactile consciousness, and mental consciousness of mental states, ideas, concepts. These six kinds of consciousness are changing all the time. You can only have one of them, stay in one of them at a given time point. So it's like inside the house, it says blinking six lamps. You open the door and says nobody, there's nobody home, but there's just six lamps blinking. And the only one of them is blinking at every given time point. But in all cases, whatever you call this house, and even if you stack the houses up in a five-story house, calling it all me house, all clusters of clinging house, all body, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness house. All in this five-story house, there's still nobody home. There's only these blinking lamps, but it's never the same. Never the same. Since nothing in the same is the same inside this house, this frame, then there's nothing that is identical from one moment to the next moment. If there's nothing that is identical from one moment to the next moment, then there cannot be any identity. Because the concept of an identity, which is the same as the concept of an ego, which is the same as the concept of a self, is that it's the same self in this moment and in the next moment. It's the same identity in this moment and in the next moment. It's the same ego in this moment and the next moment. But since there's nothing inside, there's the same from one moment to the next moment, neither inside this five-story building of form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, nor outside it, then there cannot be any self. Any same self. To give up this idea is releasing. In a sense that goes beyond comprehension. Because you're kind of like relinquishing yourself. Not only is you relinquishing the world, but you're relinquishing what you think is yourself. You're relinquishing the idea of yourself, which you have been clinging to very forcefully and egoistically, defending this idea, pretending this idea, faking this idea for a very, 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 very long time, since the beginning of samsara, for your process of individuality. But there's no egos in nirvana. The egos can be compared to this creek that is running below my feet here. This has this name, creek, let's say creek A. A44. Run down in Victoria Lake. Victoria Lake runs out up Trincomalee, runs out in the Indian Ocean. No, in the Bay of Bengal, sorry. The Bay of Bengal, there it just becomes ocean. It loses its name. It's the same water that's running below my feet here that I give a name, Creek B44, that runs out in the ocean. But there it loses its individuality. The creek is not the frame that holds a creek in place here. It's the water that's the creek. It's the stream of water that's the creek. So this same stream of water, when it runs into the ocean, then it loses its name. It loses its designation. Same thing with this stream of consciousness. It's also streaming along. When it enters nirvana, it loses its name. It loses its individuality. It loses its particularity. But since there was no ego and self in the first place, it was only a cage which the consciousness has taken over its own head. A golden cage which kept in the bird, the beautiful bird of consciousness. And then nothing is lost. You cannot lose an ego you never had in the first place. Huh? That's impossible. So since there was no ego to lose, one loses nothing by seeing that it's not there. Actually, it releases consciousness into a phase transition from local to non-local, which is gradual and smiling all along, all the way down to nirvana, the ocean of nirvana. 95 minutes and 9 seconds. Question 45, which 145, which is the last one, is no, it says more than one. Is lying for the benefit of something wrong speech? Yes, definitely. The fourfold definition of right speech is avoiding all lying, pretending, and any false speech, abstaining from any kind of divisive, splitting talk, refraining from all aggressive and irritated scolding, and stilling of any idle and empty gossip. But the first thing is avoiding false speech. if you're invited into court and you want to protect somebody, the typical story is, there's a Buddhist standing outside a forest. A hunter comes with his weapon, his gun ready. He asks the Buddhist, did you see the deer run into the forest? The Buddhist says, yes. He doesn't lie, he doesn't say no, because he wants to protect the deer. He wants to protect the deer and also the hunter from the karmic return of killing the deer. But he don't want to lie. So the hunter says, did it went into the forest over there? The Buddhist don't say anything. Silence, noble silence. Hunter's confused. He asks again, did it went in over there? The Buddhist doesn't say anything. Did it go that way down into the river? The Buddhist said, no. So it doesn't give any directional information. He wants to protect the deer and protect the hunter. So he keeps noble silence. So lying for protection oneself or protecting others should not be done. And just no answer. Don't give an answer. Don't give a false answer. No answer is also a very strong answer sometimes. Because the hunter has to ask himself, why do I get no answer? Why do I get no answer? And there his path actually starts. His way of reflection over how this Buddhist is thinking. He's standing there with his gun and he wants to kill. Why does this Buddhist, why does he you know, doesn't say anything? Sometimes he says something, sometimes he doesn't say anything. Why is that? His path starts right there. So it's a forceful statement in itself. Noble silence. Is lying for the benefit of something wrong speech? Yes. Lying, false speech, is always false speech. Then there was question 146, and this goes like this. What is the karmic consequence of insulting and thinking ill of the Lord Buddha? And there one hits a karmic catastrophe, which comes up like a probability wave and smash one's down. And one experiences, though one is physically staying in the same place, probability speaking, one is falling vertically with the speed of light. So one will have an acute downfall in all aspects, futures, situations, events, options, and choices. One will experience failure, collapse, frustration, lack of success, being disrespected with flat contempt. One will experience disintegration of one's body, social relations, economy, social destruction, self-destruction, breakdown, ruin, health-wise, socially, mentally, economically. One will have bad luck, mishappenings, illness, fiasco, lack of success, inadequacy, decline, shrinking, deterioration, degeneration, sinking, decaying, waning, fading away and disappearance of all joy, success, satisfaction, gladness, and forms of happiness. So this one should not do. This one should not do. One runs into in a wall and is knocked down without understanding why. That's very sad. The opposite is this respect for the Buddha, which comes by contemplating his unique qualities, which we will do now, because this ends Dhamma on Air number 44. Again, thank you to all the donors. Remember to click subscribe down there. If you want to support or go to the website and come to know more, or assist the forest Sangha, hover with your mouse up in this corner and click the small white eye. Then there will be 5 links scrolling down. And if you drag down, scroll down for you to utilize. Lastly, may you have a nice day. Namo Tassa. pakavatto. Arahatto. Samma sambuddhassa. Worthy. Indeed worthy. Perfectly enlightened. Knower of all worlds and all dimensions. Trainer of all those who can be tamed. Guide and teacher of gods as well as of humans. Blessed, exalted, and awakened was the Buddha. Thank you for your attention.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.